Welcome back to the show. As I promised you, we go to the WATR phone line where we greet our three special guests this afternoon. We have operatic tenor James Valenti, singer Giada Valenti, and the man who wears many hats, Filippo Voltaggio. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining me on the show today.
Hi, good afternoon.
Hi, James.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Giada.
Buongiorno.
Ah, Filippo. So, I always thought to myself, like, whenever I get more than one person on, how am I going to do it? But I'm just going to give you guys the mic and let you talk. I know that yesterday would have been the day of the 25th Sergio Franchi Scholarship Memorial Concert up in Stonington, and people know that it's been postponed till next year. So, on that note, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, we were just saying to each other that we miss seeing each other. Of course, it's always a great opportunity to see all the fans, but also to see some great artists like James and Filippo that I get to see not that often as I would love to, but the Sergio Franchi is always a great opportunity to see each other and to have a good time with great artists like that. So.
Oh, that's excellent.
Yeah. I mean, I first sang on the concert in 2001, and I met Filippo at that time, so it's been great to reconnect with him every year. And then Giada, of course, I met a few years ago.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, we're all very different artists. We all bring very different things, but it's a fun day to sort of share our talents together and just have a lot of camaraderie offstage, too. That's where a lot of the laughs happen backstage.
Yeah.
You know what? I love all your music. It's beautiful, all the three of you. You know what I wanted to ask, now that I have all three of you on the phone, in your opinion, what does... You know, I know that a lot of this revolves around Sergio Franchi. And to each of you personally, what does Sergio's music mean to you? Did it influence you in any way towards your career? And if so, how?
Who would you like to answer first?
Any of you guys, or all of you, however you want to answer it.
Because, Giada, you want to go ahead?
Sure.
Well, me, I mean, I was born and raised in Italy. And even though Sergio is Italian, I discovered Sergio when I moved to the United States 13 years ago, and I've been listening to his music and meeting so many people that I actually met Sergio. I did some shows in Vegas, and I met musicians that played with Sergio, and everybody's saying what actually Ava is always telling us, that Sergio was a unique human being, an amazing artist, but also an incredible man offstage. And this is, I've heard this from every person that had the honor and the pleasure to meet Sergio. That Sergio was an outstanding artist and an amazing, amazing human being. So I feel honored to, and it's a little bit sad that that in Italy we have not had the pleasure to have an artist like Sergio Franchi, which is basically really amazing and incredible. So I feel blessed that I've been able, thanks to Sergio Franchi and Ava Franchi, to get to know this his music and an amazing artist that he is. So I feel honored and I, you know, when I go back to Italy, I tell all my friends about Sergio Franchi and about his music, and I'm sure some of them, even the ones that are listening today to us from Italy, they have discovered his music thanks to the Sergio Franchi Memorial Concert. So this has been my experience with Sergio.
Thank you, Giada.
Who's next? Filippo or James?
I'll take it if you want. Yeah. I discovered Sergio's music around the time I met Ava, which was 2001. I knew a little bit about, you know, from that period, Mario Lanza and some of his things, and I got in touch with Ava, and then I started to really discover Sergio's artistry. And it was actually very funny. One of the first times I met Ava, she said to me, it was very nice comment, she goes, "You remind me of Sergio. You look like young Sergio." which I thought was always a very sweet compliment,
sure.
Of course, because he was this very dynamic, handsome guy with this sort of really kind of beautiful, dark sort of, you know, warm sound. And as a tenor, you know, I definitely appreciate what he does and his versatility. You know, he can come out and sing the Lord's Prayer and Knock Your Socks Off.
Oh, yeah.
And then sing, you know, one of his more pop songs. And he had such a great versatility and range and style. And so it's been a pleasure now, as the concert has gone on, to bring his name and his artistry to others. You know, I mean, a lot of the young tenors that come in there, you know, aren't as familiar with him. And then we hear a couple recordings and see some of the videos of him doing Corin Grato and stuff, and everybody's like, wow, this was a great voice. This was a great singer. So it's the concert is always a great day for Ava to also get excited and keep his legacy going. And so it's been a pleasure to get to know his work and to see, you know, when you walk around the house, to see him with all these former presidents and stars, and the guy has quite a life. You know, he really was very, very so accomplished in so many different aspects, you know, in classical opera, of course, in Broadway and Vegas. And so it's been a pleasure to get to know his work through this experience.
That's excellent. Thank you, James. How about you, Filippo? What do you think?
I grew up with, like James was saying, so much Italian music, and included into the mix was, of course, Sergio Franchi. And so I was really honored when somebody came up to me and said that I reminded them of Sergio Franchi and that they wanted to introduce me to Ava. Come to find out, it wasn't his voice. It was his jokes. and the irony of it is that I used to tell stories and all of that long before I ever knew about the Sergio Franchi concert. And then when Ava invited me to the concert the very first time, I had all my stories prepared. And the night before the concert, I said to her, I've got a great story to tell. And she said, story? You're not telling any stories. You're just going to sing. And I said, oh, but. And she says, no, nobody tells stories on this stage. And she says, we have a comedian. And at the time, she used to hire a comedian to come and bring some a light moment, because it was a lot of opera, she said, and it needed a light moment, and that's what Sergio was good at. But when I offered to do that, because I wanted to do it anyway, she said, no, you're not going to do that. That's not why you're here. And so the morning of the concert, I went up to her and I said, but this story is so good. She said, stop with the story already. There's no story. You're not going to talk. You're just going to sing. It's okay. You're going to be fine. And just as I walked on stage, I said, you know, if I told this story, and she looked at me, and the two of you, James and Giada, know exactly what I'm talking about. She looked at me with those eyes like, you with the story. And then she said, okay, I'll tell you what. You do your story, make it short, and if it's not good, I'm going to break your legs. So I still have my legs, but when I walked off stage, she said, you're not only coming back next year, but I'm not hiring the comedian.
Hi.
She says, you're going to talk from now on.
That's great.
And so there it is.
Wonderful.
Well, I know my family always loves hearing your stories, you know, about the lady in church and whatever. I mean, it's like my family's always like, when is Filippo coming? When is he going to tell his stories? You know, it's like you're like a highlight of the concert.
Yeah. That is awesome. Well,
it's true.
Likewise, we all have heard about each of us how Giada is my favorite, James is my favorite, Filippo is my favorite, and the nice thing is that for a lot of people, we're their favorites in the sense that, you know, you're their favorite because you come out and do the classical tenor, and Giada's their favorite that's a beautiful thing. Hey, maybe the three of us should go on the road together.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, actually. We could really sell it.
You could.
The three V's.
No, you guys
Valenti,
are great.
Valenti. Yeah. And Voltaggio.
That would be good. You guys could go in Vegas.
It's very funny because people often think that Giada and I are related. I mean, we just sort of, you know, we kind of play it up now because we have the same last name, of course. So everybody's always like, is that your wife? Is that your girlfriend? Is that your cousin? You know.
We decided we are cousin now, right?
Yeah.
So we have a story to tell. We are cousin. Yeah. So.
That's funny.
Well, that's funny. People think Giada and I are related too, but it's not because of Valenti. It's because of, what is it because of?
Together, we're always like having fun. So
they
must know each other. And it's funny because Filippo, when we are at a party and introduce to you new people, we always said, well, I met Giada 30 years ago. I'm like, what? I'm like, I'm in America for 13. So, and if the first time you introduced me, you really believed that you know, you met me for your whole life, almost. And I'm like, no, we're only friends since 10 years or something. But it feels indeed like we know each other for a long time. And the both
Filippo, of I don't know if I ever told you this, but do you know how, do you ever, guys know how Facebook sometimes does an automatic tag of like your face recognition? There was a yes. period of time, for whatever reason, where whenever I'd post a picture, it would automatically think it was you. Something about our face structure. It would say, Filippo Voltaggio. I'm like, no, that's me.
Maybe we're related.
Maybe we're related somehow through Facebook facial recognition software.
Yeah. We are a big Italian family.
That's for sure. And that's, Joe, if you're still with us.
I am.
Joe, are you there?
I am. I'm just listening. This is great. I'm enjoying myself.
And actually, yeah, what Giada just said and James agreed, how we're a big Italian family. That's something that really was cultivated, that Ava did by bringing us all together. And afterwards, there's a party for the singers every year, or she just would introduce us to each other. You know, that kind of thing that we really, it wasn't like a competition. It was right away camaraderie.
Right, right.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, definitely.
That's beautiful.
And I don't know your experience, Guy, but for me, the Sergio Franchi is always an highlight of my year. So I'm always looking forward to be part of it, because really it's not even about the singing, and it's about the whole experience, the staying together, that having fun, the see Ava doing all the stuff that every year she does. We all love her for yep. the way she is. It's just fantastic. And all the people that come there for us, and they are so kind to all of us, and every year there is a new singer, and somehow Ava is always able to bring a lot of talents there, but also nice people. There's to be We became even friends with more people. I think it's very special.
The atmosphere is very, like, I think the word camaraderie is sort of perfect, because people come there, maybe they don't know what to expect, and they come, they see us joking around, they see us doing, you know, all the centers at the end of the Osceola meal, and it's sort of just this fun day. The weather's always, knock on wood, is always fantastic, and it's just a great way to end the summer. And it always my birthday is actually always the week after the concert, and it sort of coincides.
That's like, right. Happy birthday. Yes.
Happy birthday, James.
Happy upcoming birthday,
James. And I love what you just said about, you know, the family energy. And I was just going to share this quick story about last year. We had a sort of after party at the home, the guest home where I was staying. And Alfio busted out his guitar, and in the kitchen of his house, we were all just singing Italian songs for like an hour, just in the hall of these people. Yeah. And Filippo and Giada were there, me and this Cesar, this other tenor. And it was just like this impromptu, let's just make music together and laugh sort of, you know, sort of time. It was so great.
Actually, I had been invited to a party prior to that, and I invited Alfio to come with me. So we were at that party. After dinner, he pulled out the guitar and did that. And then Giada was texting me saying, where are you? We're over here. And maybe you too, James. And so Alfio was about to leave and go back to New York or something. And I said, there's another party. So thank you for keeping that fun going.
It turned into a great impromptu night, and the people were in the home I was staying were just absolutely delighted, and as were my parents. My parents were there too, and they were like, "This is like even better than the actual concert."
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Well, actually, we should probably mention also the people who do open up their homes.
Yes.
They're friends of Giada. They're friends of the work that she does and that we do, but some of them have become like family. It's been a beautiful thing all the way around.
Yeah, the community up there in the Stonington area has become like a little family for us, for sure.
Yeah, I always stay with Angela and Steve. I love them really. Actually, last year I was in the New York area. I didn't know where to go. I didn't want to go to a hotel. I called them, and I stayed for a couple of days in their home again. outside the concert. So it's and they're special, and they really open the house for you. The community in Stonington is amazing. I mean, everything around it's set. I'm sure you guys are set to the next year is going to be the 25th and the last one. Can you believe it? Not doing this anymore.
I don't want to believe it.
No, me neither. I think in a way or the other, another way, she's going to figure it out a way to keep doing this. I mean, I want Ava to keep doing this forever, but I don't know.
Well, my parents and aunt and uncle are up in Stonington this weekend anyway. They always stay at the inn in Stonington, and they have the reservation, and they just love the area so much, they just decided to go up anyway. So they've been there all weekend anyway, going to some wineries, and I think they're at the Ocean House in Rhode Island today, and they're just sort of enjoying the weekend there because it's just such a quintessential little town, you know.
Well, if next year, I'd like to propose that someone bring a backstage camera, and you're laughing already. There's so many shenanigans that happen backstage.
Yeah, that's a great idea, actually.
Sometimes can be kind of acting.
Yeah.
This is a fun language sometimes in used backstage, but I know it's the fun is backstage, actually.
Yeah. Actually, Giada, I was just thinking that, you know, you and I don't think have ever sung, properly sung like something together. Filippo and I did last year, we did the Be Italian and the, was it New York last year?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. But I've never done anything with Giada. We got to figure out something to do next year.
We have to figure it out. And if we have to bring the show around the country together, we should better figure it out.
Well, that's interesting, James, because I was thinking also how after we've gotten to know each other and we've seen each other at different events and festivals and whatnot, I've gotten to sing with Giada, I've gotten to sing with Alfio, and I've gotten to sing with you, and then you and Alfio have sung together in Washington, D.C., I think. And
we sang in the IF of the Gala last year,
Oh, cool.
Wow.
So, that's cool.
I missed the IF Gala, by the way.
And we have...
No, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. Is Joe talking?
Because I was. I was back here thinking for a minute.
I was talking.
That's
Joe,
okay.
Can't you see we're trying to talk?
No, it's fine. I'm enjoying it. Every once in a while, I have a thought, and I try to interject it, but I'm not successful. But you know what? I was just going to say that you guys are just great. I love seeing you all perform at the Sergio Franchi show, and I'm so sorry that I didn't get to the last one. Obviously, you guys had a great time without me, but that's fine. What are you guys all planning? Like, I know everybody's doing their own work. What's next for each of you as far as, you know, like, for Giada, I know you're working and doing you released your DVD and CD for Menace with Love. Do you have anything coming up, James and Filippo? What's on the horizon for all of you guys? You can continue your conversation, just answer it later.
Who go first?
Well, with me, I am so busy with the Life Changes show, and we're in the process of taking the Life Changes show that's now on radio, happily on 75 networks throughout the world now.
Of course.
And taking it to a live stage where people could come and experience the stage. And we're actually taking it to a whole other level in a way that's never, a show's never been done before, literally, because the technology never was there. So we're going to do the show in a dome with 360 virtual reality. It's quite impressive. So if anybody wants to check out what that looks like, we've started a page for that, so they could go to our website at lifechangesshow.com and click on Patreon, and that link takes them to a video of what that looks like. But one of my dreams is, when that's mounted, to be able to have Giada and James on the show at the same time.
Nice.
And for all three of us to sing, or wouldn't it be great, LaTanya and Jesus? I mean, we just bring back
<That's>
and Alfie, of course.
Yeah, that would be fun. I'm in, so I'm sure we are. Can you handle all of us together in one show?
I can handle it. Well, actually, James mentioned New York, New York. Didn't everybody get up at the end of that?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, we did. Yeah.
That's true. With our sunglasses on.
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, so that's great. Are you finished, Filippo? May I take the stage now?
I'm not finished, but please.
No, go ahead.
No, I'm kidding. Go.
No, I wasn't sure. No, I'm just I'm just performing actively still. I have a recital coming up actually in New Jersey where I'll just be doing an art song recital. So I'll be doing some Duparc and some Rachmaninoff, some Russian songs, some Italian songs, of course. So I'll be doing that, and then I'll be doing my normal opera thing. So I'll be working mostly in Germany, Switzerland, Austria. My normal repertoire, Tosca, Carmen, Butterfly. And I'm also doing a lot of teaching. I'm actually just finishing up a master's degree in vocal pedagogy, which is teaching, and I have a number of private students. And I would like to, down the road, my sort of five-year plan, I'd like to sort of be on faculty somewhere, like Manhattan School of Music or Curtis or something. Still perform, but have that sort of stability. And, as we all know as performers, it's a very taxing, difficult life to be on the road all the time. And I really find that I'm enjoying teaching very much and sort of inspiring the next generation and passing on my knowledge and passing on these traditions that, you know, of the art form that I love. And I like it. It actually is even making me a better singer, because to break something down and to talk about technique and talk about breathing to a young student is very challenging, but I like it. It's sort of like I'm stretching a new muscle. I'm learning that I'm actually a pretty good teacher. And so I'm doing that in addition to my performing and
3 minutes,
sort of where
stations.
I'm
oops, 3 minutes.
Sorry, that wasn't
what's
for you.
That?
No. Go ahead. That wasn't for you. That was a mistake on my part.
No, it's okay. No, that's it. That's what I'm up to. So
that's awesome.
And before it is awesome, and before Giada goes, James, I hope you continue your modeling career on Instagram. Well, actually, both Giada and James, I have to say that they find the most beautiful outfits and they take pictures of themselves and they look great, and so we enjoy
so
that
do
just
you.
Just
so
putting
do you.
I no I don't do it as much as, I don't do it like that but you two, so I just saying I'm enjoying that. For those of you who want to follow them, James Valenti, Giada Valenti, you could follow them on Instagram and enjoy that too, along with everything else they do.
Well, James really does it like a top model. I'm always saying he's a superstar. Yes, the stage is very tall, like a model. Me, I'm a little one, so hey, what can I do?
Oh, and then he goes to these really fantastic places all over New York. I'm on the top of such and such a building here at this great party, and so I like to live vicariously through both of you in that
well,
way.
New York and the summer is just great. Rooftop bars everywhere, and you know. Yeah. It's been pretty good all summer, so I'm pretty
awesome.
Social guy, so take advantage of it.
Yeah, I'm always enjoy watching both of you, what you guys are doing, so it's, keep doing both of you. So well, are we done? Can I say what I'm having in my future? Well, everybody knows, I think October 11 I'm going to have my debut at Carnegie Hall, which I think I dreamed about it already for 5-6 years, and finally October 11 I'm going to have my debut at Carnegie Hall.
Congratulations.
I'm actively working on preparing the filming for my next television special for PBS, because the one I filmed that is currently on PBS, I filmed it 3 years ago, so we are working, and hopefully we're going to have it on PBS next year. So I'm working on that, and all the people, I'm sure James and Filippo, they know there is a lot of work. I'm an independent artist, so I have to put together everything by myself, and it's a lot of work, but I love it. And of course, I'm going back to Vegas. I keep doing my concert and my things, recording. Last year I went to Mexico to record some duets with some Latin singers, and I have to finish all the material. So I have a lot of stuff that I started and I need to finish, and then I'm going to have new music coming up soon. But basically, the PBS special, the new one, and my debut at Carnegie Hall are going to be two of my highlights for the month of October. So I'm pretty much looking forward to do that and keep working. I mean, as James said, we are always traveling, and so is Filippo, and we are always working on what we love so much, but takes away a lot of our personal life. That's why we take a lot of pictures with clothes, and we make ourselves happy. We do happy while we are traveling like crazy from left to right, and doing thousands of things now. But I'm happy that you, James, are teaching kids. You're an amazing artist. I'm sure the students that you have are blessed to have a teacher like you. And you, Filippo, you are amazing on the radio. You know that I've been your guest several times on your show, and I must say that you're always doing an amazing. You have a beautiful singing voice, but I always tell you, you have a very great voice for the radio too. You are calming.
Yeah, you got a face for radio too.
Yeah, he has a face for radio too. Yeah, but that's different.
Well,
that's,
and with that, we have to break for a commercial, don't we, Joe?
Yes, we do. We do. We might as well get him out of the way. This way we can go to the top of the hour. James came on and he goes, we're going to talk for a whole hour. See how quick it's going by? It's already been a half, right?
Well, I'm sorry. Could you repeat that?
No, I says, when we came on, James said, he says, geez, are we going to talk for a whole hour? And it's already been a half. See how quick it goes by?
It goes by quickly. Yeah, that's true.
Okay. We're going to take a commercial break. This is 1320 WATR. This is Carosello Italiano. We are blessed to be on the air with three top-notch performers. We have James Valenti, the operatic singer. We have Giada Valenti from Venice. We have Filippo Voltaggio from the Life Changers show. And what an honor it is. We're going to take a commercial break. We'll put our guests on hold. We'll be right back after all these messages with the rest of the show. So everyone stay tuned. Okay, you guys, don't hang up. I'm going to put you on hold, all right?
Okay.
Okay, hang on.
Okay.
Okay. Let us get back to our guests. We have James Valenti, Filippo Voltaggio, and Giada Valenti on the line. Let's go back to our special guests. Thank you all three for joining us and being so patient today. Welcome back to the show.
Our pleasure. Thank you.
So, what else can you tell the listening audience? I mean, we've been having a great conversation. People are loving it. I was just telling you that I've got about 60 people coming at me from different ends saying, oh, this is great. We love it. Keep it up. We love your listener. We love your guests today. So anything else that you could tell us? We still have about 15 or 20 minutes to go. If you want to talk about, you know, what your favorite moment in your performing careers were, if you have a favorite moment, or what you like to perform the most for your listeners, that they request the most from you, anything like that.
Joe, before we go on, I wonder if now that the show is going to be podcast after it's aired live, how do people listen to that? Or will you post that or both?
I'm going to post it, and I'll tell you as well right now. We were very lucky that there is an Italian nonprofit group that is located in the St. Louis area, and they are known as Ciao St. Louis. And I can give you the link for it. Ciao St. Louis has agreed to carry our program in addition to four or five others, and then they go in rotation. And you can go directly to where the podcasts are. You, for people who want to know, it's Ciao St. Louis. It's C-I-A-O-S-T-L, Ciao S-T-L, .com / Ciao-Radio / Carosello. So for people that don't have time to write that down, I'll post it on Facebook at the end of the program where the show, where the link is easy to find. Thank you, Filippo. Sorry, go ahead now. You can continue.
Well, actually, so I'm going to share my favorite moment of the Sergio Franchi show, and actually you posted it just a couple days ago on my wall, Joe.
Oh.
And that's a picture that I've never seen before of My backside.
Oh, jeez. You're waiting in the wings there, though, I thought.
And Giada Valenti's backside.
Backside.
And her backside looks great with that beautiful dress. I don't know what's going on with me, but you've just inspired me to change my body and change my life. So thank you, Joe.
What's wrong with that? Wait a minute. What's wrong with that picture? I thought it was great because, see, we're not having a show this year. And I thought that if we posted that picture, you see Giada and Filippo are waiting in the wings to go on stage, but it won't be this year. It'll be next year. So it's kind of a little
perfect
story. There was a story with it, so.
There's nothing wrong with the picture. Giada looks great. My hair looks great. All is good.
No, the dress looks great. You were wearing a dress. You wouldn't look great, too, but you were wearing a dress.
I don't know, Giada. I don't think so.
But it's a sweet picture. So, I know. The backside is not our best.
No.
Part, I think.
Well, but working on it. Now, did you happen to have a picture of James's backside? Just curious.
Exactly. I do. You know what? I have a picture. You're not going to believe this. I have a picture of James. Now, I know, like, James is very serious about his work. And the last few times I was at the concert, and I went to take his picture when he was walking up to the stage. I have a picture of his hand in front of the camera. He's like, oh, I'm going up on stage. But it's probably because we didn't know each other at the time. And you know, I came out at the last minute with my camera when he was going up there, but he was like, up, going up on stage, talk to the hand, you know.
Well, I don't remember that. I certainly didn't mean to do
No, I'm
you.
Just kidding. But I know. No, the one picture
of the,
I...
Because of the construct of the stage, there are oftentimes when, yeah, we're about to go out and perform something very difficult, and people are, like, coming over.
I know.
Hey, can I get a picture? How can I? And it's like, listen, I love the fans, but there are times where we need to focus.
That's right.
And do our job.
That's,
you know,
right. I have one of your pictures when you were in that moment.
You wouldn't have access to the performers like that as before they're about to get on stage, so... I don't remember that, but I apologize.
No, stop.
Anyway.
It was just, it's meant to be funny, and there's nothing negative or to apologize about. I love your work as well. As a matter of fact, I wish I could. I was all set to come to see you guys this year, and I was almost heartbroken when I found out that it was postponed until next time. But that'll give everyone a chance to get together and, you know, come up for the final one, and it'll be a great, great time with many, many, many people in attendance. I think there's several thousand that come up. I remember one year there's like 4,000.
Yeah, they get a good. They definitely get a big draw for sure. 3,000-4,000, you know, minimum. Yeah.
So we're looking forward.
Hey James, weren't you on the poster for a couple of years?
Oh yeah, I remember.
I think maybe once or twice. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
I just kind of splashed my face up there. It was always all Sergio, and then I had like a small little, you know, headshot on there. So.
Yeah, I've never been on the poster. Giada, have you? Just out of curiosity.
I've never seen the poster, so I don't know. did you get to see the poster? I've never seen any posters. So I don't know. I hope it was not my backside, anyway. I don't know.
Speaking of posters, I wanted to thank, I think it was Giada, who I want to thank so much for putting up that wonderful flyer and posting on Facebook saying that we were going to get together today. What a beautiful design that is. You have Giada, you have Filippo and James, and then you have Ava and Sergio, their silhouette in the background. I think that was a really beautiful design.
Thank you,
Giada. Whoever did that.
I got to check that out.
It's very nice. It's on Facebook.
Thank you. It was done by my assistant, Natalie. So she's the one that she was actually last year for the first time at the Sergio Franchi. She's from France. And even a French girl was in love now with the Sergio Franchi. She was so upset that this year was not happening, but it's happening next year. But she did that artwork for us. So I'm glad you like it, Joe. It's our pleasure. It's always a pleasure to be your guest.
Thank you so much. And, you know, I'm so glad. I feel that you, it's great to have you guys on, but I feel that we could have probably done more if I had you guys each on an individual phone line, and I hated to do it this way, but because I'm all by myself here at the station, it's easier. We do have one phone line operating, but it's easier to have everybody come in on the one line. So I wanted to say thank you.
This is actually really fun like this.
I want to say thank you.
Yeah.
No, thank you. Yeah. It's fun.
So I was joking about the picture, but I would say that at least at the Sergio Franchi, it's really hard, and that's a good thing, to pick a favorite moment at the concert. I mean, and even career-wise, because I, like you said at the beginning, I wear many hats. But as far as I'm concerned, I've got so many more hats or bigger hats to wear. So
sure.
I just keep enjoying as many moments. And like Jada said, and I know for James as well, we're just so busy. But this is our life. You know, some people are posting pictures of their kids and their happy birthday this and that.
Uh-huh.
Every time we're posting, it's because, you know, we've been doing something. So picking just a moment is hard. But there would be moments on stage that have been very special at the Sergio Franchi, and like we mentioned earlier, moments off stage which are very special, and moments before. I'll share with you actually a very interesting moment, and unfortunately LaTanya couldn't be with us on the phone either, but LaTanya Moore, who is an amazing singer and a good friend, first to James and then to us as well. But I just saw a picture, James, that you took, and I'm grateful for that, that when LaTanya was pregnant with her first child, I think it was, at the dinner before the concert the next day, I sang to her belly.
Oh, that's nice.
Or to the baby. But I sang to the baby, but while I was directing it towards the belly. And we all thought I was crazy, but... But let me tell you, that's a beautiful baby. So, hey, you know, who could argue with results?
So when if somebody's expecting a baby, please call Filippo Voltaggio with her baby, and you will look spectacular. Oh, yeah. Talking about LaTanya, one of my, I don't want to say my favorite moment, but the most funny moment was, last year or the year before, that there were some change at the last moment. Ava cut out some singers and the schedule changed. So I was still in the room getting ready, and suddenly I hear people shouting my name. Yeah, waiting for you on the stage. I think it was last year or the year before. And then I had to run on the stage with the shoes in my hands, and I had to change my lipstick, and I put a very bright pink lipstick. And I was about to go on stage. Ava was, of course, saying, "If you're next, we change it." So I'm about to go on stage, and before I'm ready on the staircase, and LaTanya, she stopped me and she said, "Smile," and I'm smiling, and she, with her fingers, she cleaned up my teeth because I had lipstick on my teeth. And I thought, wow, this is LaTanya. You know, she's an amazing singer. For people that they don't know her, she's like a superstar of the classical music. She's an amazing human being, but I mean, she has done amazing things in her career. And I was like, man, I just said LaTanya cleaning my teeth with her finger, and she saved my teeth. Otherwise,
she had your back.
She had my back. And it was very sweet. That he says a lot about what kind of friends we're really helping each other there, because it's just like everything can change at the last second.
Well, I think that was 2 years ago. I remember, because the second half, we were under a bit of time constraints, and Ava was doing some last-minute changes.
Yeah.
It was a little disconcerting for a lot of us, because we didn't know the order. And actually, if I remember correctly, also, Tanya got bumped up, and she actually went on stage with no shoes on, because she just kind of got, you know, she didn't have time to put her shoes on.
And, oh my God, that
kind of changed around the order.
Yeah, it was 2 years ago. You're right. Yeah,
that was actually the year that we didn't get to do the O'Sullivan meal.
Oh, it's true. Yeah,
because
right,
we didn't have enough time at the end, so it was a bit.
Yeah.
You know.
And I was actually going to say, in the same vein, that you asked about, you know, favorite moments or favorite things.
Yes,
I really love the ensemble portions of the show. I love, you know, when I had a chance a couple of years ago to sing with Filippo, and I love the duets, and of course, the at the end, you know, the tenor of Vanessa Dorma, La Donna Mobile, also the mio thing for me is, you know, it offers just a bit of levity, and it's just, I'm not normally on stage with my tenor colleagues, you know, in an opera world,
sure.
setting. So it's fun to just be up there with each other, having a little competition, you know, holding a little longer than the other one. You know, but it's all done in good spirits. And I find that, this is just my observation, but tenors, Sergio was a tenor, Mario Lanza, Luciano Pavarotti, tenors have a reverence and respect for other tenors. I've noticed this across the board. There's something about the sort of, I think, the mentality or the sort of the pathos of being a tenor that we love hearing other good tenors. And we get excited when we're all on stage together, laughing, having a good time, you know, showing each other up a little bit. It's not done in any kind of vindictive or jealous way. It's like, it's really, really enjoy it. And even during the concert, when, you know, my friend Derek or Jesus will sing an aria and it's really good, they come off stage and we like high five each other, like, man, that was awesome. Nice. That, you really nailed that. You know, and we kind of lift each other up, and it's a nice sort of camaraderie, and it's not jealous or you know, in any kind of way like that. It's not negative.
Wow. No.
What a great, thank you for sharing that, James. That's a great story. That's awesome to have that camaraderie. Sure.
Agreed. Thank you for sharing that, James. And I have to say, you know, as people probably know, I'm a life coach. And one of the things that I coach people on is exactly what I wasn't doing when James asked me years and years ago, I want to do a duet with you, Filippo. And I thought, oh, right, that's a nice thing to say. He's a tenor. I mean, he was, you know, singing all over. And I completely different style of music and all that. And then a year later, Filippo, I want to do a duet with you. It's like, yeah, that would be nice. And I thought, you know, but it took, I don't know, 3 or 4 years. And then finally, he just called Ava and said, I'm doing this.
I was like, come on, man, let's sing something together.
And you did great. Your duet was amazing.
We did the Italian.
The Italian, right.
Because you guys are friends, and it was so much fun. And it was, I think everybody remembered that moment, and everybody loved it. I personally did. So.
Yeah, that was a highlight that year, I think, for sure.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, I love it too. And it transcended the friendship that you guys have.
Because our voice range and our voice type is very different. But we, you know, we kind of met in the middle, and we had a lot of fun with it. So.
Yeah.
Nice. Agreed. And I feel like along with obviously being grateful and mentioning Ava, of course, which, by the way, just the fact that we're friends and the fact that we're talking about this and the fact that really the whole town is buzzing and so many people are disappointed that they didn't get to come really goes to show what one person can do and how one person can positively affect so many people.
That's true.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He's really built an amazing thing there.
Yeah. Is Ava listening to us today? We don't know, right?
I don't know.
Somebody will.
I don't know. You know,
Ava's also, I mean, you kind of mentioned the way, but Ava is also a big part of the show. I mean, we never know what she's going to say. We never know what kind of faux pas she's going to make. But, you know, it's brilliant.
It's brilliant. Yeah, I know.
We love you, Ava.
Thank you for everything.
I adore Ava. Yeah.
She's the most gracious host as well. Hostess.
Oh yeah, she is.
Yeah, she is. And actually, I had the pleasure and the honor 2 years ago to spend more than 10 days living with Ava. Was in transition. I was moving from New York to Los Angeles. I didn't have any place to go. I went and stayed with Ava. And it was an incredible experience. The house of Ava is like Sergio never left that house. There is so many memories. And Ava loved to share all the spaces, the things that happened in the house. It was amazing. And Ava is an amazing human being. I mean, the love between Ava and Sergio is a love story that's still alive like never ended.
It is.
Still with us.
Of course.
And I mean, I was having breakfast in the morning. There is these pictures in the kitchen of Sergio that look at me, and Ava was talking to me about Sergio. I almost felt that the picture was really Sergio alive. It was magical. It was 10 days that... So I have to thank Ava for being not only an incredible host during the concert, but she really loves all of us. She really cares for all of us.
Yeah, she's great.
She always stays in contact through the years around the holidays. There is always Ava. There's always Ava there for us. She comes when she can. She comes to all the concerts we do.
Yep.
She's there supporting us. So
she came to my debut at the Met. She's come to many things also. Yeah. She gave me a really beautiful gift at my Met debut. It was a La Traviata score that Sergio had. And he had all his markings in, his breath markings, his things, and she gave that to me as a present, which is really very, very special and unique.
That is a special gift.
Oh, wow, that's awesome. Yeah, she's listening. We love her, and we miss seeing her this year, but she has already the date for next year. I think it's August 24th, so, guys, we know where we're going to be next year.
Yeah.
I look forward to that. And it being the last year, there might be other singers there as well who haven't been around for a while. And I just kind of feel like as we're coming to the end of the hour, we probably could mention a few. We've already mentioned LaTanya Moore and Jesus Garcia, but Michael Amante and
David Miller and Sarah Joy.
David Miller
from
El Divo.
David Miller and Sarah Joy. Yeah. Right.
Of course,
Roberto Yeruzzi. Right.
Yep.
Who else? The Denolfos.
Ian and Lisa.
Ian and Lisa Denolfo.
Number of years, but yeah.
Yeah. So many wonderful people over the years. Derek Taylor.
Derek and Evelyn.
Oh, Derek, of course.
And Evelyn
course,
Taylor,
Derek.
Right.
Evelyn, yeah.
Love them. So many wonderful people.
We love that she can invite everybody next year. But, we have to have like 4 hours concert. Which nobody
Frank Tenaglia.
Frank Tenaglia, of course, he always seems to be my love like nobody else. So, yeah, what else? Corey Pesaturo, he always come and play the accordion.
That's right,
for us.
Of course.
Right. Alfio, of course.
Alfio, we mentioned,
somebody. Yeah, one year we had Maria Leda with us. She was amazing.
Maria Leda,
she was there, and
It's been over the years. There's been a lot. I mean, we're sort of the stalwarts. You know, we're like the ones that people know, and I like to think to come and see us because you know we've been there so long. I mean, my first time was 2001. When was your first time, Giada?
I've been there for 11 years. So what was 2000? I think after you.
Okay.
I've been there 11 years in a row. So it's 2018. So it was 2000, and I'm very bad with number.
Filippo?
Seven.
Filippo, how many years
that
for
was
you?
My first,
24?
Yeah.
You know, I think I came in the third year she was doing it.
Okay.
I think it was the third year.
Yeah,
and then I missed one.
Just that, yeah.
So,
oh, one?
Yeah, so not quite 24, but maybe 21.
Great.
Wow.
That's awesome.
Yeah, only 11, so... Yeah, it's amazing, right? I mean, incredible. I still remember the first time I did it, so it was 2007. I was here in America only for, I think, a little bit less than 2 years, and I remember I was invited to, and I sang Caruso. But by the way, the first and only years I sang something in Italian. All the other
Giada.
Years, make,
by
yeah?
the way, we did, that's the song I wanted to tell you. I was having a senior moment. We did play from the Italian Signorina CD. We did play Caruso. That was the first song we shared.
I love that.
Today by you. It is wonderful. It's one of the best versions ever. And,
thank you. Yeah, it that's the first song I got into the Sergio Franchi singing Caruso, and never you know. It was the only year I sang in Italian. All the other years I sing it either.
Giada, maybe we could do that as a duet next year.
That would be lovely. I did the speaking part, and then you break the audience.
That
would be lovely. Yeah, it's never been done as a duet, I think.
Oh, that's beautiful.
So we can do the Valenti cousins duet.
Yeah.
It's an idea. I mean, you still have the arrangement. I sing it in the original key, which would be good for you. So it's an idea.
Yeah.
You know what's lovely is to connect with the two of you and you, Joe. Thank you so much for bringing us all together.
Thank you, Filippo. Yeah. I know we're at the end. I'm so sorry that we are at the end of the show. But ladies and gentlemen, we have been listening to three great talents. We have James Valenti, Giada Valenti, and of course, Filippo Voltaggio. With us here talking on Carosello Italiano about the wonderful memories of the Sergio Franchi Memorial Scholarship Concert. And I want to thank from my heart all three of you deeply, including James. I am going to come and see you and get a great picture with you during the next concert. And it's going to be in a time when you don't have to go up onto the stage, of course. And Filippo, I'll talk to you again soon. And Giada, I wanted to, before we go, I wanted to say thank you because I remember when Robin and I came to the NIAF, the gala in Washington back in 2015. We came there to see Evolo. Who did we run into? We saw you. We were so happy to see you at the concert. I said, Robin, it's Giada. She's here. Remember we saw you at the concert there? That was great.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, you and Robin are always very kind to me, so I appreciate it very much. And it's always, you know, for me as an immigrant, when I see people that remembers my name, know who I am, I'm like, oh, it's like family to me. I have somebody that knows me. So you guys have always been great.
Thank you.
Great to me. So I'm very grateful. Thank you for having us today.
Thank you. Thanks to all three of you guys. We're going to go. We're going to play a part of a Sergio Franchi song on the way out. And we'll talk to you again. Once again, the link for the podcast will be up on my Facebook page, on my page, and on friends of Carosello, or listeners of Carosello Italiano. And I'll share it with each of you guys as well. Thanks again. This is 1320 WATR. We leave you with Sergio Franchi, Non ti scordar di me.
Tirano le rondini dal mio paese freddo e senza sole, cercando primavera di viole, nidi d'amore e di felicità.
Boardroom and costumes that she has worn throughout her career. But most recently, of course, the French Tennis Federation, the president was not happy about her attire and spoke about it and said, this is President Bernard, if I'm saying this correctly, Giodicelli, I probably didn't. He said, you have to respect the game and the place. He said, we're going to ask that manufacturers to let us know what is coming. I believe we have gone too far. And this is in reference to, of course, Serena and the cat suit that she's worn and some of the outfits beforehand. What's interesting is one thing about social media, you can't say stuff like that without us pulling out some track records and showing some things in history. I'm going to show you, and maybe I'll tweet it out for those K-Dub Live for myself, Bucky Brooks, so you can see it. This is Ann White at the Wimbledon in 1985. What does that look like to you?
It looks like an all-white catsuit.
An all-white catsuit, because of course you wear white. It's Wimbledon, it's an all-white catsuit, but it's still a catsuit nonetheless. It looks exactly like Serena's, except instead of black, it's white. And so there has been precedent, and I understand, and what's interesting about this, Serena actually hasn't really been upset about this. She says, look, you know, a lot of it's because I have blood clot issues, and this suit, you know, the way it's made, it's tailor-made for me and those issues, my health issues. So she said, we'll find something else. Maybe we'll find some fishnets that will help.
Oh.
So, but Serena wasn't that upset as many fans were. But the bigger question to me is, when is it okay to go at your biggest star? If you're the PGA, not necessarily Tiger Woods now, but you know, Tiger Woods of 7, 8, 9 years ago, would you go at Tiger Woods on some, hey, can you calm down the fist pumps? Can you calm down the, you know, can you turn down the volume of that red shirt on Sundays, Tiger? If you're the NBA, are you going at LeBron and Steph Curry about something? About, hey, LeBron, you know, you're dancing too much during warmups, or you're having too much fun. You know, those rap videos that he always does on his social media.
Yes.
You know, whatever the case may be. We have seen now the NFL go at their biggest star, Tom Brady, because of the whole Deflategate. And they didn't let that go. They rolled that thing until he just finally gave up.
Yeah.
So the NFL has shown us, we knew beforehand, but now it's really confirmed that we don't care how big you are, or who you are. It's the shield before anything. But I don't see the NBA doing that. I don't see some other leagues doing that. I'm getting Tiger Woods and the PGA. I don't see them being that hard when it comes to something like this.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that the French Open would choose to go at Serena Williams in this manner. I don't know what the ratings have been, but she obviously is the biggest draw. She's the biggest draw because people either want to see her win or see her lose. But regardless, when Serena is in the finals, it's going to draw a big number just because there's so much intrigue about her and will she continue to set records when it comes to accumulating Grand Slam wins. You know, look, I get it, and I get dress codes, and I know at Wimbledon they had a dress code. You have to wear all white. I don't think there's such a dress code at the French Open. This is the first time we've heard them
kind of
mention something about clothing and attire and what would be proper and being respectful. I just think you have to be careful when you throw the respect word out and what's respectful or not. I just don't think I would go at Serena about this publicly. Privately, maybe we have a conversation, ask her maybe to tone it down if it's something that could be an issue, but to go public with it, man, it's just not a good look. It's just not a good look for the Open.
I don't even mind if you decide to have a dress code. I'm fine with that. You play in the NFL 5 years, Bucky. You know, you can't do this. Your tile can't be longer than 6 inches. You can't wear the gloves that are opposite colors of this and that. So I don't even mind that. But it's more the attack of specifically Serena, you know, kind of coming at her is what made it interesting. If they just said, hey, you know, I don't know if you all knew this, but we just implemented a new code. Here it is. Here are the rules. Okay. We all get it. We all have worked in places where there are rules and regulations. But I didn't like the word respect the game or the phrase respect the game. We are going to ask, you know, you have to respect the game because to me, respecting the game is the way she's trained, the way she's prepared, the way she's been a champion, the way she has inspired young women and even young men.
The way she conducts herself,
her character. To me, that's respecting the game. She's not showing up late. She's not cussing out, you know, the umps and referees. She's not, you know, being belligerent. Like, I respect the game. To me, that's the aspect of it, the way she carries herself and her character on the court. So I was a little bit taken back by that. But then I thought about it a little further. Do you think it has something to do with her body built? Because she is very curvy, voluptuous. I don't know that, you know, this very, I guess we'll stick with curvy woman. And I wonder if that has something to do. I would imagine that has something to do with it as well.
I'm sure it has something to do with it. I'm sure he just didn't want to see that. Maybe he made an executive decision. Maybe there were some people that were offended by her choice of really tight clothes. I don't know. It just seems kind of crazy because she brings a lot of attention, a lot of good attention to tennis. I just wouldn't want to do anything to detract from that. And maybe he felt like, look, I'm going to put this out there for public consumption so everyone knows, so it's not a big deal when the Open comes back around. I just think you handle that conversation privately. You don't have to make it a public conversation. But now you have put her in the spotlight and you have allowed the Twitterverse to come back and fire back.
You don't want to get the Twitterverse going.
No, like at least she doesn't have the crew like the Beehive.
She doesn't have the Beehive or the Kobe fans. Those are the two fan bases you do not want to get into it with. That's for sure. Hey, legend Billie Jean King actually had something to say. Speaking of Twitterverse, she tweeted out, the policing of women's bodies must end. The respect, in quotations, that's needed is for the exceptional talent that Serena brings to the game. Criticizing what she wears to work is where the true disrespect lies. So even she had to say, you know, something to say about that. But again, I thought about that, the partnership generally that you go to the NBA and how that's a rising sport right now, how that is becoming more and more, even more popular, of course, here in the States and even worldwide, globally. And I think they just have a great relationship with their stars. They have a great relationship with the individuals in the sport. They have no problem saying, hey, Steph Curry, be as big as you can be. Hey, LeBron, be as big as you can be. And we'll actually help you with that. Hey, LeBron, do what you want. And it seems like they work with it. Like, guys, remember Hoodie Mello? When all of a sudden Mello started wearing the hood? You guys remember this, right?
Yeah.
Remember,
yeah.
Mello was wearing the hood, and do you know, you saw what the guys were wearing in the NBA, right? The warmups?
Yeah.
Hoods. Out of the blue, the NBA warmups had those hoods. What are those like? I don't know if those like bobsled jackets or skis. I don't know what
you're trying to get right. That's a Nike deal. Got the little hood on, got to get your mind right.
No.
Get your headphones.
I have one of those.
Get your headphones
hoodies.
Right.
Do you know how hard it is to get in those because they're so tight around the neck and the hood part is so small?
Need to be shy. I want to be nice and tight and warm.
Well, you are definitely tight wearing that. That's for sure, man. Those hoods are so tight. But my point is, the NBA didn't say, hey, don't do that. They said, all right, you know what? Hoodie Mello and people are there enjoying that. Let's bring the hoods to the game. So, again, I just thought this was a bad way to go about one of your biggest stars. But I tell you what, more people were offended than actually Serena was. So when you kind of read into that, you're like, maybe I need to fall back a little bit and relax if Serena isn't as upset about it as I am. Let's take a phone call here. This is Scott. Scott in Colorado. What's going on, Scott?
Not too much, guys. Thank you so much. Long-time listener and frequent caller. You know, and I certainly want to hone in on what you're talking about with the cat suit controversy.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a lifelong tennis player and fan. I've been to all the Grand Slams. I've worked the tennis classic at the Bank of the West in Stanford University, and I've sat with the next to the Richard Williams before, and I don't agree with his behavior. But, you know, listen, I don't really mind, even though Billie Jean King is ripping the French Open for what they've done, I don't really mind what the French Open has done. And you know what? And I kind of take issue with that everybody is tuning in to watch Serena play. I really think most of my tennis buddies are just, they're kind of just turned off by the Williams family, you know, been around too long. Love Sloane Stephens, love Madison Keys. You know, I go back to Chandler Rubin, so it's not a black-white thing. But, you know, Serena has just never, she's never given kudos to her opponents. There's that perennial scowl whenever she plays. And, you know, it just, and I know that this may detract from the issue here, but, you know, when I saw Serena show up in that suit, I'm just wondering, like, who is telling her that that looks good on her, you know?
Well, so, Scott, I would be one. I thought it looked great. I'm just going to be honest with you, Scott.